Now I'm seeing your Sapala. And I'm so touched that so many people under 21 are here. That means a lot to me. The last time I was, my work was in Brazil, as some of you know, it was censored in Rio. It never happened in Sao Paulo, but in Rio. And I don't know if you know the details, but my work was in Oi Futuro, the phone company, and somehow it got to the attention of the bosses that my work was a letter to pedophilia, that I was putting forth pedophilia, and that's what my show was about. There's a tiny kid section in The Ballad of Sexual Dependency, which doesn't have any sexual content, but it shows kids as children are, as they really are. And that includes touching each other, touching their parents, and being touched. And sometimes they're in rooms with people who are nude, but this is the way children should grow up, to my mind. Anyway, they found out about it, and the Christian right, or Catholic right, I'm not sure, got involved in this and accused me of being a pedophile, and it got censored. And then it was moved to the Museum of Modern Art, and there's a beautiful book that goes with it. But the same slideshow showed in Sao Paulo at the Biennale in around the same time, and there was no problem. So it's only in the eyes of the beholder, as we all know. I'm really happy to be here again. I haven't been out of my hotel room yet, but it's a great hotel. It's designed by the son of Otaki.
Homer Otaki.
Yeah. So, you know, it's got to be good. It looks sort of like this building, which is, to my mind, completely insane, but fabulous. So I hope somebody will take us to a good gray bar or a tranny club after this, or at least tell us about one. I introduce my studio, my manager, and my friend, Sam Roque.
Hi, thank you. And we'd also like to say thank you to the Institute Tomi Otaki, to Paolo, Vittoria, Marcella, Mana, and there's one more who I'm praying, Eloise. Thank you all so much for the organization, support, and everything you've done to bring us here and have Nan talk in front of you.
I made him say that because I don't remember names very well tonight. I'm too nervous.
So we had talked about maybe starting off with the other side and showing that slideshow. So do you want to say some words about it before, or should we just jump in?
I made a slideshow with pictures starting in 1972 when I was a teenager, called The Other Side. It's named after the bar that we went to every night. I lived with, at the time we called each other drag queens. I don't know if it's politically correct anymore, but I lived with the queens for 3-4 years, and I had followed them on the street. I saw them, and I had a Super 8 movie camera, and they were on their way to Goodwill to buy second hand-me-down fashion. And I shot a little roll of film, and then, oh my God.
they just go on and on.
I had no idea. What are you doing up there? Anyway, I filmed them and I fell in love with them. My love for my people comes before the photographs. But in this case, the photographs gave me a way into the world that I wanted to be a part of. And photographing them constantly, I became the house photographer as well as the house pickpocket. I stole all the fashion magazines every month, just French and Italian Vogue. That was my role. But anyway, in the process of living with them, I took the pictures. I wasn't a photographer yet. Like, I didn't know anything about art photography. I only knew fashion photography. And my dream was to put the queens on the cover of Vogue. Now, thank God, there are transsexual people on the cover of Vogue, but it's taken 40 years. But at least I'm still alive, so I can see it, and it's huge to me. I took the pictures to the drugstore down the block, and then I got little snapshots back. I brought them home, and each person would make a pile of the snapshots of them and compete about who had the most pictures of them. So anything they didn't like, they tore up. There was no issue about me being vicarious or voyeuristic or in any way abusing the absolute trust of my friend. And that's the secret of my work, if there is a secret, since I always talk. But it's that people can trust me because first I meet them before I start photographing them. Generally, I'm in love with them before I start photographing them. And then the trust is established because they always get to see the work. And they can always rip it up, which actually Louise Bourgeois did to one picture I took of her. She didn't like it, and she made sure I didn't publish it. She tore up the negative. But anyway, I appreciate that. It's good editing for me. I know what to edit. And I put the slideshow together with music of the time of each section. And the pictures go from 1972 to 2006. So it covers a lot of territory, all the way from Boston, where we grew up, to New York, to Manila, to Bangkok, and Paris. So here's the show.
Around 3 o'clock or so, I meet with friends to have a bite to eat and conversation. We talk and empty out our hearts on every subject from the arts to liberation. We love to pull apart someone and spread some gossip just for fun, or start a rumor. We let our hair down, so to speak, and mock ourselves with tongue and cheek and inside humor. So many times we have to pay for having fun and being gay. It's not amusing. There's always those who spoil our games by finding fault and calling names, always accusing. We love each other, but it seems the love lives only in my dreams. It's so one-sided. But in this life, I must confess, the search for love and happiness is unrequited. I ask myself, what have I got? And what I am and what I'm not? What am I giving? But answers come from those who make the rules that some of us must break just to keep living. I know my life is not a crime. I'm just a victim of my time. I stand defenseless. Nobody has the right to be the judge of what is right for me. Tell me if you can, what makes a man a man? Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care. When you put your arms around me, I get a fever that's so hard to bear. You give me fever. When you kiss me, fever. When you hold me tight, fever. In the morning, a fever all through the night. Sun lights up the daytime, moon lights up the night. I light up when you call my name, and you know I'm gonna treat you right. You give me fever when you kiss me, fever when you hold me tight. Fever in the morning,
fever all through the night. Everybody's got the fever. That is something you all know. Fever isn't such a new thing. Fever started long ago.
I want this for you.
I think there's three people still living in this show, and I'm one of them. And Joey. Joey's still alive, thank God. But I'm old now, so this is the time in my life I would expect my friends and my community to die. But these people died, and we were in our 30s when these people died. And it's kept going because of AIDS and drug addiction and depression. And the funeral that Joey and I are at was for a queen who was standing in front of Penn Station, and a man came up behind her and slit her throat. And the police watched it and did nothing. That was in the early 2000s. So when I watch it, it's more like a memorial for me. And I think there's four people in the show I don't know. So that's what I mean about knowing the people I photograph. I've known all these people, most of them deeply. Some of them were great artists, like the second transsexual that I do a portrait of. Her work was incredible, and it's really only been really appreciated now. It was so sad because she wanted it to be appreciated so badly in her lifetime. And the wonderful thing is I ran into the star of the black and white work, B, who I hadn't seen in 40 years. And she came up to me on the streets of New York about a month ago. And that means everything to me. And she said there's only three of us that have survived, her and me and one of the queens who you see a lot of, Marlene. And everyone else in those pictures is gone. So for me, it's just not fair. That's the bottom line. It's not fair that we lost our community so early. Most of the people that were meant to carry my history died decades ago. So these were the goddesses. These were the goddesses. Those black and white pictures. This is before there was language for it. They were just queens. And I lived as a drag queen also. I wanted to be a drag queen. It never occurred to me in all those years that these were men dressing as women. I never thought of it. And somebody said it to me about 4 years into living with them. And I was shocked. And now I recognize, then it later got the name third gender. And I guess that was what I was living. I wasn't living a woman dressing as a man, a woman being a man dressed as a woman. I was living in the third gender.
In being around the Queens, both in Boston and then later New York, do you think, this slideshow is really emotionally hard to watch, and it's also really emotionally hard to watch in front of so many people. And it's also the other thing is, like, you know, through your work, I know them through your work, and I have putting the prints together for Portland. There's like this, and which is the
it's your community too. I mean, yeah. You're one of the standard bearers. One of the youngins coming up.
Yeah.
But this is your community. And I wish that you could have met these people.
Yeah. I mean, I know I wish every day that I knew them, and I know all of my friends do. But I think, you know, the fact that they do live in your slideshows and your work is, you know, in some small way our way of connecting to them. And I think that's something that I think a lot of people find to be really true about your work, is that it is a very true, real way of connecting with these people. And I think maybe I hadn't really put it into words until this morning, but when you're talking about being at your hippie free school and there are no classes and you being like incredibly shy and not being able to talk to people, and then meeting David Armstrong and him kind of pulling you out and then introducing you to the Queens, and you interacting with your the relationship and the way that your photography developed with them feels very tangible and very present in the work. I wonder, you talked very eloquently about it this morning, about your sense of kind of connecting with people through the camera, and like that kind of the love affair that comes out of that. I wonder if you could repeat it for our guests.
Okay. What did I say? You said a few things, and I would say that I didn't really have a social self until I met the Queens. I grew up with them, and they really are the goddesses, because they had it wasn't easy then at all. There was no language for it. There were no jobs. Later, my friends worked as hairdressers or stylists or makeup artists or other jobs not related to or fashion designers or artists. But in the 70s, there was only prostitution. And that's across the board for most Queens, most transgender people who are not middle class. That's still the basic option. So many Queens end up on the streets, and once you're on the streets, you're never gonna get a job. It's very rare to be picked up from that. And for transgender people, what are the options? Anyway, about your question, what was the second question?
Well, I mean, we can actually talk about, because I think we're also, we can come back to that, because where are we going?
Yesterday I was being interviewed, and it wasn't very successful. And I, one of the questions I was asked was, you're a passionate person, how many times have you been in love? And I said 3. But in fact, I've been in love multiple times. I was in love with one of the queens in the black and white pictures. And there weren't terms for it at that time for a woman who was in love with a drag queen. And the only representation of my experience I could find was in a book that said, a book about psychology that said, these people are too sick to even write about. That's what it said. But what I mean about being in love is the way I felt about Kenny, the way I felt about B, the way I felt over the years about which of the queens did I fall in love with. Some of the most passionate relationships, I'd say Joey, I was madly in love with for a long time. So I, instead of lovers, I have my photos. And sometimes they fail me, and like lovers do, and sometimes they feed me.
And just to circle back to the...
I don't even like photography. Why did I say that?
I don't... You do talk about how...
I don't like photography.
Yeah.
I mean more being in love with the people in the pictures.
Yeah.
And I still have them in my heart, like, after anybody breaks up.
Yeah.
But it's not the photographs I'm in love with. That's bullshit. Sorry.
No.
I didn't mean that.
But is there something in, like, the act of being with the person and then developing that trust, and then that kind of going through the photographs, like the... And that it's like, it is a way of making love in some ways.
Yeah, it is. It's good sex. Photographing somebody you're really close to and love enormously. To try to get to the root of the person, to try to break the screen between you and that person, and then break the other screen of prints of photography, to try to make them breathe. Make them real.
Yeah. And we read that quote earlier about the chromatic overcharge, and like the kind of the body in your work as a like through color. But I mean, I also see it in the black and whites. But I think it's most easily seen in the color work. This the kind of intensity of color being a kind of means or like a metaphor for flesh or for the body.
Yeah.
And in that way, like the prints themselves are living in some ways. Or
thank you. I like that. I hope so. I hope that comes through.
Yeah.
I mean, taking a picture is one part about making a record of things. And I'm glad I have this record. I'm so blessed that I have this record. But it's also about getting through this situation where you do find trust and where the person shows the deep. When I think about the phone, for instance, it's a great recording device, but has anybody taken really deep, meaningful, intense pictures with a phone? Has anybody? No? Yeah? Step right up. You should be talking.
But I mean, I think that's
there's
also
more people raising their hands.
Now we've got.
Oh, great. There's hope. There is hope.
There is. Though, I mean, phones do seem incredibly, I mean, you're saying, like, you can't get these true deep photos, but I also feel like you can't have true deep conversations or connections or anything with people through phones. And we were walking through the park yesterday, 2 days ago, and literally everyone we saw in the park was just on their phone. It was incredibly, it's a New York thing too. It's not just, we take full credit for that as well. But I wonder, so, as like a, because it's not like, and I think this is the difference between your, or at least the way we talk about your work and phones is that it's not simply a recording device. It's like a metaphysical tool.
It can make magic.
Yeah.
I mean, in spite of me always saying that I didn't care about cameras, I didn't care about the technology, I have fallen in love with another kind of love, with a couple of cameras in my life, because I feel that the lenses let magic in. They let the light in a way, Leica lenses in particular. There's something they see that I've never seen another camera be able to see. So I found my medium in that regard.
But I think your medium is also really strongly music and the way you kind of use music in the slideshows and in the little thing we worked on the other day, talking about, you know, adjusting the slides and making, working to make the music kind of intrinsic part of it.
Yeah.
And it is like the songs are so deeply connected to the images. The images are so, like the two things are inseparable once they're together. It seems like after they go through Nan, there's no taking them apart again. And when they're like,
yeah, I want the work to be like almost ambient sound of what the person, the place was at the time. The songs we were listening to are the songs that were really meaningful to an individual. And even the room sound in my piece called Scopophilia that I did at the Louvre, it's a woman singing old Latin work,
yeah.
Old Latin with an incredible soprano. And we recorded it in the Louvre. So it has the room sound. It's like it has the same space in the music as it does in the images.
Yeah. And in Scopophilia, like the sound and the images are, I mean, I guess that seems like the most kind of, now that I'm saying this out loud, I'm realizing it's not exactly true.
Sound-based work?
Well, no, but that the most kind of like physically located together in their origin. Yeah. And I wonder like what that kind of transition was, how that came about in terms of that piece.
It was that other soundtrack people's idea. I was working with great people.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't entirely. Where that idea.
But you do have a very collaborative.
Yeah, I do.
Practice.
Very. Basically the people who work for me, I work for them more than they work for me. And regarding my work, we work beautifully together. All the people through the years I've had assistants are collaborators. Some of them have become true collaborators.
Yeah. I mean, you do have this amazing kind of network of collaborators scattered about the globe that kind of come and go through projects and are also very intrinsically linked to those projects, at least in my mind, I'm guessing.
Yes.
We were talking about Scopophilia. And so was, because that the music was composed for,
yes,
for that slideshow.
Right.
And was, in terms of working with the composer, how was that collaboration, how did that collaboration come about or manifest itself? It's such a different, different way of working from the other slideshows that I know.
But it wasn't, she was collaborating with me, but
yeah,
it wasn't an involved relationship. She was recording for me, and I listened to it, but I didn't work with her.
Yeah.
Like I do most of the time with people. Do we show the...
Pardon? Do you want to show the...
Yeah, I want to show you a little piece that's not good, but it was made for Sao Paulo. We made it in the last few days, and it's about Sao Paulo in 1996, about one bar.
Eu não sei dizer. Nada por dizer, então eu escuto. Se você disser tudo o que quiser, então eu escuto.
dedicated to the Otaki Foundation. Thank you. This is the way I start to make a slideshow. So it's always better for me to show my work than to talk about it. That's where I feel confident, is showing the work. And this is showing the way I work, the beginning of a slideshow. It's very rough. It's not edited properly. And we listened to a lot of other music, and this seemed to be ideal. But I think there's lots of other music. And if people have music, that's how I found a lot of the music in the ballot. And yeah, people all over the world would send me music. And this was in the 90s and the nulls, or whatever they're called, the zeros. But mostly in the 80s and 90s, people sent me music from everywhere. So if you guys have some music, please leave it at the desk. No, please tell me about it, please. Does anybody recognize anybody in the pictures? I guess it's really old-timey for you guys. Does anybody recognize the bar? No? Yeah? You must have been a baby when you were in that bar. It still exists? Okay.
No.
Anyway, I don't remember the name.
Yeah, we don't remember the name. We're hoping one of you did.
Yeah. And it was published in a magazine, which I don't remember the name either. But if anyone ever finds a copy,
send it to the
please
studio.
Send
please
send it to us. I think that explains my work pretty well.
Yeah.
Like the whole way. I mean, these were not close, intense relationships, but I told them that I was the oldest living drag queen photographer, so they liked me. And I took pictures and I showed them to them. And then I photograph. I think you need to go to a place and know where you are and know who you're with, and then go back and take pictures. Just a thought.
I agree. It seems to work.
This one looks really old-timey.
This, yeah.
That's a crew.
It is an amazing group. I mean, you're saying, you just said that explains your work really well. I feel like there's also, you know, this newer development of your work that this doesn't touch on, which is these drawings and paintings that you started. And also, there's more here. And also we have like in terms of work that you're working on now, and not only the beginnings of this slideshow, but also the drawings and paintings. I wonder if you can talk about where that trajectory has kind of come from. And
when I was a kid, I drew and painted all the time, and most of my paintings were of the apocalypse, because I lived under the fear of nuclear war, because in America there was something called the Cuban Missile Crisis, and we were told that Cuba was going to bomb us, and we had to go under our desks and run home. And if you got home in less than 20 minutes, you would live. I think the teachers just wanted the day off, so yeah, they sent all the kids running.
That also seems like the most traumatic way to dismiss a class. 20 minutes. I didn't. Yeah. That's terrifying. But it also feels like something that's very present today.
Oh my
too.
God! So I every morning I would go down and I'd say to my father, "War for sure," all my me and my siblings, and that was the text of my life at that time. I was living in horror, like it was in my body, the fear, and now it is again. I'm afraid Trump's gonna blow up the world, even Brazil. I'm sorry to say. And you didn't do anything to deserve it, nor did anybody. Anyway, you can't live without knowing what's going on now.
Yeah.
So I've come back to trying to paint the apocalypse, and it hasn't worked yet. But when I was like, I don't know, 10 in school, my teacher said, "Someday you'll be in the Museum of Modern Art," my painting teacher. And he was right, but not yet for painting.
Soon.
It's so good to get back to it, though. I mean, I've been drawing. The drawings are my diary, and I've just started to show them. They were private. And the paintings are something else. It's such a wonderful medium. I feel so good when I'm painting, and I don't have to deal with my shyness. It's me and my paints. But I'm learning a lot about color. I'm learning the medium as I go along. I'm trying to understand many, many things. I've started to paint non-figurative, but it's only two paintings, so we'll see. Anyway, it's amazing to have a medium that you can touch, that you can put your hands on. After 40 years of having to use white gloves, it's amazing.
Yeah. And it is also, it seems like the directness of it seems to be really exciting for you, at least in watching you do it, that there's this like immediate like mark that is made rather than, you know, the going through the processes of
everything. For me, I've always thought that drawing was the truest art because there's nothing between the human hand and the paper. And so that mark seems absolutely real.
Yeah.
It's not going through any processes. Yeah. Anyway, we should be talking about sex and drugs. Everyone looks so bored.
What do you want to say about sex?
I don't have
and
much
drugs.
To say.
Oh, we do have a drug, the opioid, that you had wanted to.
Yeah, I wanted to pontificate on this subject, which is the nearest subject to me. I live in fear of Trump, and I want to get more politically involved. I want to be on the street, and I want to be working with the transsexual kids, the homeless teenagers on the street. And the LGBT Center in New York is taking people in and feeding them. And I want to get involved in that. But the major thing happening that pertains to me personally and that I passionately want to get involved in is the opioid crisis in America. People are dropping like flies. And I'm a survivor of the opioid crisis. So I understand it so well. I understand why people do opiates. I understand how hard it is to get out of that. And what's evil is this family called Sackler, who have museums all over the world, and they made billions off OxyContin. They made an empire off pain medication. They pushed it and pushed it and spent that money partially to give to museums and galleries, and they basically washed the money in these, what they saw as I don't know, giving.
Yeah, like cultural give back or. Yeah.
And it didn't pay back anyone. I mean, those museums, those beautiful wings of the Metropolitan, or the museum they have in Boston, or the new museum in London, they're beautiful, but they're made on the backs of hundreds of thousands of people now. And what I want to do personally is boycott those museums. This is the first time I've said it, except to Sam. And this is what I want to start. If it's not happening, I can't tell you how much your support means to me. That's incredible. Thank you. Gives me the power to go out and do it. I don't know how else to get to these people. They've been sued so many times, and they've always settled out of court, and they've never admitted that they were responsible. Never. I mean, there's a lot of pill mills, they're called, where doctors dispensed thousands of prescriptions a month. And particularly to poor white people in the middle America and the South, got decimated by the opioid crisis, wiped. But at the end, it's this one family, the Empire of Pain. And I don't know how to get to them. So I think the only way to get to them is through their philanthropic projects to make people aware how dirty they are.
And I mean, it is also it's a cause that is connected to you on two levels, on like a personal level with you, but also because they support every art institution in America. Not every, but a vast majority of their presence is enormous in the art world. And yeah, I think.
Well, they think they're philanthropists, so yeah. That's a way to us. To run, to hide.
Yeah.
I recently came off opioids, the same opioids that are killing everybody. So I'm a survivor by a few months before fentanyl hit the streets. So I went into treatment in January of this year and came off all drugs. And particularly opiates. And if I had stayed using my drugs, I would have been given fentanyl, for sure. That's this drug that they use to, I think, to tranquilize elephants. And it's 100 times more stronger than morphine. And it's coming out of China. It's used in surgery, I think. And all the dealers are including it in the street drugs. And they're even producing pills, prescription pills. They look like prescription pills with fentanyl in them. So that's why everyone is dying so fast.
And in your time center coming out of recovery, which has been incredibly short, and you've done an insane amount of stuff in your life since then, which is kind of mind-boggling to think about the last 6-7 months and everything that we've done. I'm wondering if you want to touch on the new projects that we've made, like the Document Magazine, or maybe like and how. Maybe, I mean, it seems like, at least, you know, from my kind of personal daily experience of you, that the further you've gotten, the more days you have, the more kind of involved with making you are again. You know, when we first met, you were like, I never want to pick up a camera again. Right. And now we just finished a booklet for Document Magazine, of your work. And so I'm wondering if you see a connection for yourself or if
yeah,
that's
absolutely. When you come off drugs, it takes a while, but it's evolving. Definitely it's evolving. And I kind of realized I like photography because it's easier to photograph the apocalypse than it is to paint it at this point. I mean, the skies in New York, sometimes over the water, look like it's the end of the world. So I keep finding the apocalypse in nature, and I keep photographing it. I guess my passion right now is shooting landscape, or the sky. I'm a sky photographer now. I love the sky. I remember when I was a teenager, there was this man who was a newscaster in Boston, and he quit his job to go watch the sky all over the world. It was a group of people. Incredible.
They traveled the world watching the sky?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So ever since then, I look at the sky every day, and it also keeps you grounded and recognizing the size you are in the world. Because as an artist, if you stay in your studio, you can think you're the beginning and end of the world. And only by getting out and meeting a lot of people who didn't know who I was, and that was shocking to me at the beginning, and now I love it. And then I found my right size in the world when I met all these people who didn't know who I was. They didn't even know who Andy Warhol was. anyway, maybe we should show. I've had to do fashion work for money. I'm not a rich artist like people think. I'm not, if you only knew. But, so I've had to do fashion to make some money. And again, I've fallen in love with my model. She's become my muse. She wasn't a model. She's my best friend's daughter. And I've used her in the last four jobs I've done. So we also have some slides of the Document magazine. Just, and this is her first love. And this has been made into a book in a fashion context. But there's no distance between my fashion, except there's some nice clothes.
But, oh, sorry. I have a quick question for you as we're going through this. In putting this together in this image in particular, you're talking about these sky photographs. In the editing of these works that you took in Biesenthal, and you know this sky from where in Ireland is it? Galway. The editing process is, I feel like, as much a part of your work as anything else that we see and experience. And the way you compose books in particular is, you know, it has that mangled and genius that it comes with you.
I love making books. I love it.
Yeah, and it is also some of the happiest moments I've seen you is shifting things around pages. I wonder, does doing something like Document and the editing and like the editing and putting that together, does that change the photo or the image?
Of course.
For you? And
I mean, the relationship between images always changes them in some way. I mean, I don't know how to put it in words. I guess these are both about beauty, which is a valid thing to pursue in art. People say, oh, that's only beautiful. But beauty is such an amazing gift of the, it's like God's gift to us, if there was a God. It's like a miracle, beauty. So I think looking at beauty, using it in your practice, it's a great thing rather than a thing to diminish.
Yeah, and as in your life as well, I think. You know, we were talking about the queens and their lives being about beauty, from like their entire life being about beauty. And I think that's something that people have a tendency to kind of maybe, I don't know, doesn't have the best rap.
No, it doesn't. Beauty is a way to put people down, their work down. Oh, that's beautiful, only beautiful. Anyway.
The things I do to love me with all my faults. The way that I love you, I'm begging you. Don't make me over. Make me over. I wouldn't change one thing about you. Just take me inside your arms and hold me tight and always be by my side. If I am wrong or right, I'm begging you.
I was just a baby when I started this.
Il mio cuore